Mane, tēnā koe, welcome to Q&A.
Kia ora e Jack. Nau mai haere mai ki te pū o Ngāpuhi.
Tēnā koe. Why did you want this gig?
I guess one has to be quite intentional at my age and wanting this gig, I guess, when I reflect and think about it. We're kind of born into it in some ways. You know, I love being Ngāpuhi, everything about it, the complexity. So that's come from being born into our iwi and growing up with Ngāpuhi challenges. And you start to get a sense early around what responsibility is, what working together is in marae and hapu settings. And so I guess the drive has always been there from birth and growing up in a strong Ngāpuhi family, well aware of history and legacy of our tupuna. So it was somewhat natural to head towards the space, but really you have to make a decision somewhere along the way and say, right, I want to try and make a difference with our iwi, at an iwi level.
If you don't mind my asking, ihi o tau, how old are you?
35.
Has your relative youth been a hindrance at all?
I don't see it as a hindrance. I do acknowledge along the way there are challenges of being at this age. Both, I think, historical or in a historical context. And when you're talking about iwi tribal politics, there's this challenge there or thinking around sending tamariki into those real big spaces and big issues and big topics. So, but I think there's legitimate rationale, reason behind it. You know, we are a war-fearing tribe, so it's along the lines of putting your best up and things. So, but also along the way, the world's changed. And our populations and my counterparts, if I put it that way, in my age, we really have our own minds and thoughts, and so we can see across the spectrum in Aotearoa a lot of our rangatahi coming through, or the rangatira of today, of the now. So it hasn't been a hindrance. It just pops up every now and then as a challenge, but I more see it as a really positive, exciting thing.
And if you think about the history of Ngāpuhi, you think about the kind of responsibilities that your tupuna would have taken on at a very, very young age, like in their teens, I suppose you can look to that and it's quite a distinct contrast.
Yeah, it is. I think if you it may rely on one's depth of knowledge of that time. It was pretty serious back then, and you know,
I mean, your tupuna were going to war.
They're going to war. It was a matter of life and death. So these things weren't played with, or we didn't have the luxury of a choice or a decision to do something or be a part of a war party, say. So, you know, I like to look at the serious nature of that context and bring it into today. I stand on shoulders of those tupuna, and so there is a level of heavy responsibility. But, you know, as we talk, there'll be continuous challenges from that time to now that we've faced that just continue to happen.
I want to talk about some of those challenges. We're speaking today in Kaikohe. Mm. By various measures, this Rohia is among the economically poorest regions of the country, and in various social statistics, life outcomes are among the worst. Many of the people on the wrong end of those statistics are Ngāpuhi. What responsibility does the iwi have for that?
I think it's been a growing responsibility for iwi. Ngāpuhi pre-settlement, as we all know, the notion of iwi across the country initially is about receiving settlement and growing the net worth and all of that. And that's been, for whatever reason, the priority. I've always felt in the last decade, iwi have had to pivot and really have a focus on social determinants rather than commercial growth. And I've always thought that the balance was off kilter in that iwi and specifically te runanga a iwi o Ngāpuhi have got to have the balance. We're probably one of the biggest employees in those sectors. My organisations and my subsidiaries, we are around 250 staff within te kaikohe, kohe across the mid-north. And so, you know, I don't take pleasure in having to have the highest number of employees in that sector, but it's a sign of that deprivation that we talk about, that we know. Jack is really quite sad, and I expressed around some of the challenges growing up, that from then to now, I was just so disheartening in my mahi and becoming the chair. And I go out and I see 80-year-old grandmothers looking after tamariki and cow sheds or garden sheds. I have to stop and take a moment to collect myself, because our people are in that struggle. And we and our subsidiaries and our kaimahi are trying our best to pull that out. So we've had to be more socially responsive. And my board, leading with my board, myself and my board, we are being socially led in terms of how we provide for our iwi. We are probably, sadly, in the best position to provide that service with throughout all of our services and other subsidiaries.
You say that you think the balance has been off, right? That there's been too much of a focus on what a settlement would mean from a commercial perspective, and that perhaps not enough energy for iwi around the motu has gone into some of those social deprivation issues. I just wonder if those two things are linked, though. If you were to say, take Ngāpuhi for an example, imagine that a settlement had been signed 15 years ago or 20 years ago, and imagine the change that could have led to in terms of social determinants because of the money that had come through. Do you think if a deal had been signed earlier, that the srohe wouldn't be as poor?
I think you could connect the two, and this is perhaps having a crystal ball in the case of Ngāpuhi, not knowing what way it could go. But I definitely think there is a connection. But I would draw the difference in terms of those two. There is a clear difference that the deprivation has been there for a long time, 150, 60 odd years. A settlement doesn't relegate the responsibility of when we signed a partnership of Te Tiriti and further Te Whakaputanga, doesn't relegate that to say if we settle we should be living in healthy homes and warm and a thriving economy. I think that's part of the discourse of not holding up the partnership with the treaty. So it's easy to say that they could, and probably hard line, yes, there is that correlation and connection, but I would also look at, in terms of settlement, what does that actually mean for Ngāpuhi? And I guess it may come to, you may have other questions, but in terms of settlement, I am really adamant on making sure. You know, we've seen settlements for the last 30 years around other iwi. It hasn't been perfect. I, for one, worked at the top of the South Island in Nelson with some of the settled iwi there, and doing awesome work, awesome mahi, progressive, with their challenges. But I can't help but think, when it comes to Ngāpuhi and the depth of Ngāpuhi, if we were to do a settlement or reconciliation, that has to be truly and genuinely in the minds and hearts of our people, of our hapu, of our marae. We can easily breeze over that, but I don't think in this day and age we have to dive deeper and truly reconcile the grievance from 1840 to now, 1835 even.
So with your perspective as an insider, where is the process for a Ngāpuhi settlement at?
There's lots of rhetoric, there's lots of guessing, there's lots of even publicity and media coverage about where a settlement is at for Ngāpuhi. What I can see in my experience is that there is a shift in our people, partly the social stuff that we talk about, partly about since the last go we had it, it was coming on 10 years. A lot of water under the bridge has happened. I think in many ways we all want a settlement of some way, shape or form. And I think that we're starting to have those conversations. I see some really positive stuff happening on the ground. Now, this isn't what a government official will see, because literally they're not at the meetings I'm at. They wouldn't be able, if I was to look at some of the advice that perhaps ministers or government receive, it's not as accurate, I would say, as what I see. And what I see is our people are ready to be who they are, to finally live how they want. We're not going anywhere as Ngāpuhi. We haven't had a good time living under this system and regime. So there's some deep kōrero happening within marae and hapū around constitution, around a settlement, around reparation, the language being used. I think that's exciting, and I think that's really, really positive. What we do have to be sure of is protection of our hapū and of our people from the multi-layered engineering or political politicking. And so, you know, part of it is that balance that I would say is around having our people ready in a state, not worrying about what to put kai to put on the table in the first instance, or paying their bills, so that they're in a state they can go to their marae, they can have a hapū hui, they can genuinely engage in what the settlement and build from there might look like. So this movement, this shift, I can say definitely for Te Runanga, A Iwo, Ngāpuhi, we have totally flipped our script in preparation for supporting our whānau and our hapū.
How have you flipped the script?
So leading with our board again and through our system, you've got to look at Te Runanga, A Iwi o Ngāpuhi in its entirety. This is an institution that was set up not by me, but by our tūpuna, some real stalwarts of Ngāpuhi Nui Tōne, the likes of Tahimi Henare being a chair, Patu Hōhepa from Hokianga or from our stalwart, and also Rudy Taylor, for example. So there has always been a genuine drive to support our hapū. And like every organisation, there's been challenges along the way. So what we've done in my leadership and taking up the role of chairmanship is looked and set, strategised around how do we totally flip the script to support hapū rangatiratanga, to support marae and whānau. Simple challenges we know about capacity, about administrative things, even organising and paying for hui. So those are the conversations we've had, and we've started a new direction called Ngā Ringa Whakaruru Kōkiri, which is about a whole shift, transformational shift of our runanga into that space, and saying to government, we will play a part in our organisation. We are a grassroots organisation. There's probably no other comparison in Ngāpuhi at this very point. We have a system where every month we meet with our marais. I, for one, meet with my local marais up to 24 at times, regularly, and look at the challenges. We also have two takiwā or system to cover Auckland, which we're really engaging to strengthen that. So the nuts and bolts are there, and we're saying we are going to do this for our hapū and for our whānau.
In the past, one of the most significant sticking points when it came to the settlement process from a Ngāpuhi perspective was the debate over the role of Ngā Tihine. And many within Ngā Tihine wanting to pursue a separate settlement from Ngāpuhi. Where do you stand on that?
I shall be very diplomatic in answering, not for any political reason or anything, because I share dual whakapapa. My whakapapa is te whānau prima ke roto o Ngāti Hine and within Ngāti Hine. and then my Tahere side in Ngāpuhi. So I've always thought that through our histories, I've always been told and learned that Ngāti Hini is a hapū o Ngāpuhi tūturu. And all that richness of kawiti and honeheke over time and battle. And so I firmly believe we are, and many, many of us have that dual whakabit, that Ngāti Hini has mana, Ngāti Hini is a hapū o Ngāpuhi. I have indicated, if I can say, currently working with Ngāti Hini and expressed to the Ngāti Hini leadership that I want this take, this wedge, as a person with dual whakapapa, or to be over in my reign or my chairmanship. So I've declared that. Whatever way and shape and form that takes, we will work through that, and we will have further hui on that. And part of our change and flipping our structure upside down is we have to listen to all hapū, and we have to perhaps even hui on it furthermore. So there's a lot of technicality in that, but if you take from my declaration, that, and I look at it in that way because it can, you know, when you go through the motions, it's tearing one apart when you have one on both sides. And it's not a good situation. When we think of the poverty, when we think of opportunity and future stuff, for the sake of my generation and both of our futures, we will see it through. I'm committed to seeing that through, whatever that looks like.
From a strategic perspective, I think about the leverage that Ngāpuhi might have with a new government that is being criticised in some quarters for its approach to issues that affect Te Iwi Māori. Isn't now a good time to reach a settlement? Don't you have leverage?
When we come and talk about leverage, sure, the new government could be seizing an opportunity to... that's definitely the sense I get from talking to ministers, the Prime Minister, that there is a real drive to settle Ngāpuhi. My number one question, though, and I have to come back to, is what is settlement? We as Ngāpuhi have to take the time to have a conversation. Is it settlement in the terms of language? Is it reparation? What does that actually mean? One will need to, and I speak personally about it, be satisfied, am I reconciled as an individual, as a whānau, as a hapū? Truly, and some of those conversations will take time, but we won't be and we shall not be rushed into pushing our whānau through those to get there faster. But you know, that's a billions and billion dollar question around to seizing that opportunity. What I am and our board are firm on is stepping out to say to any minister or person within different ministries that we are both willing to bring the well-being of our people up because we feel it's a balance, and step out and say, how do we sort of support hapū and make our structure fit for purpose so that the balance is there, and only we can have those deeper conversations. And I don't think the rhetoric from the crowd, it's not actually rhetoric. I make the comment around, some will say the government's sent pot shots or taken pot shots on a range of different issues, but for Ngāpuhi settlement. But I don't think it's a pot shot, it's a bazooka. There's things they're actually doing that are an assault on Ngāpuhi, because we are the kaitiaki of Te Tiriti, or Waitangi. Waitangi is within our rohe. Our chiefs took the initiative as well. As well as many other chiefs. We are the kaitiaki of te whakaputanga. It's a part of our ethos of being Ngāpuhi. So when those things are being shot at us, or we're being thing, I don't think they've felt the full wrath of Ngāpuhi in response. That's the big question.
And I know this has the potential to sound a bit reductionist, so forgive me for that. But could you, as chair, support a settlement that was hugely beneficial for Ngāpuhi in terms of finances, whenua. If you feel at the same time the settlement is being reached with a government that does not support you in some of those other key areas.
Mm. I will say, I will be led by my hapū and by my whānau to give us direction as their ringa whakaruru towards do we settle or do we not. Now I can see, and this one of the problems is, like I say, the depth of going into hapū and the education, because I can, that's definitely a dilemma, right? That is a dilemma around my service every day that I see through our subsidiaries and our staff and the deprivation. We are three times more likely to have our Ngāpuhi tamariki under the system of oranga tamariki. Right this moment, there's 12,000 of our tamariki acceptable to that system. 5,000 actually in there. And you know, not everyone has that awareness. They might be also in the deficit and struggling. And so it definitely does weigh on those who can see both sides and what a settlement might do. But I do think we won't settle if we don't do it together as Ngāpuhi. We won't settle if it's done to us, although technicalities might say it's settled, but the grievance is what's really... You know, the wealth of New Zealand, of Aotearoa, New Zealand probably back then, was built on the shoulders of Ngāpuhi. Our land was stripped. We are literally a landless iwi, and the biggest iwi of Aotearoa, 165,000. And so when you're looking at that kind of deficit, it's pretty staggering. And then the wealth that on the opposite. So we have to really dive deep into educating our people to find the balance, whether we settle or not, and we go for that scenario. Because, as I said, there's some hardline benefit to receiving a financial package. The models and everything will have to be arranged and discussed.
You said that there is some momentum in this space at the moment. So on the balance of probabilities, if we are to pick an arbitrary time frame, 5 years, say, do you think it's more likely or not that Ngāpuhi can reach a settlement with the Crown within 5 years?
I think it's likely. I think it's likely, but you know what? The Crown can switch Ngāpuhi off just like that, and we'll go back and wait another 5 years.
What about within 3 years? What about within this parliamentary term? More likely than not?
Well, the jury's out again. I say the bazooka's been fired, and that doesn't bid well. Also, I think the Crown and its many ministries have to show up. They have to show up here in Kaikoura. They have to show up in Hokianga. On the East Coast, around bringing our well-being up. Now, that's outside of a settlement. You have a normal responsibility to do that. And we can, time and time, say the healthy living and the access to affordable, the living cost and affordable housing, those are still issues outside of settlement that are failing. This government, previous governments, have failed for many years, decades. So.
You talked about the bazooka. There was one thing that really stuck out to me. I noted at the Hui Amotu at Tūranga Waiwai earlier this year, you showed up. And in the past, perhaps someone in your position might have made a deliberate decision not to attend a hui like that. Why did you attend?
There were many facets to that discussion. Initially, as the chair and of Te Runanga Aiwo Ngāpuhi, I pondered it. And I thought, if we were to make a move, let's make a move now. You know, that old, good old saying, never let a good crisis go to waste. And so it was seizing the opportunity around the galvanisation of Māori and the national issues. And I decided to call a number of huis, and really was taken back by the attendance of our pre-hui before we went down, and it accumulated in Waitangi, where we had hundreds and hundreds turn up. We also had a crew create a wire to go and take account of this have an account of this event. So a culminating number of things led to us to support this financially. You know, taking buses and all of these things, it was really important. Critically to the heart of all of that was it was a show of force by Ngāpuhi that we may not have settlement or millions and billions of dollars, but we have numbers, the biggest iwi in Aotearoa, frankly, the world, and that we can and will flex, as we did many times in our history, around showing up united and in the context of today having a pakanga. So it was a huge show of force. By the time we had got to Tamaki, our contingent had grown in the hundreds. We met up with our whānau in Auckland and arrived at Tūranga Waiwai. And so that was a triggering point. For this organisation, we were on the right track.
Ka pai. On that note, tēnā koe. Thank you very much.
Tēnā koe.